ज्ञानगातन कैतावशातन जया दशारतिरा
Thank you. भगवते वासुदेवाय
नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं जयं मिलये नास्तकायेषु अवतरेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवते उत्तम श्लोके भक्ति भवति नैष्ठिके
पांडवेयो महारथः
बालकीर्तनाय
कृष्णशीलं याद्यते सावै भागवतो राजा पाण्डवेयो महारथः कृष्णकीर्तं यातति
सा
बाय
सर्टनली
भागवता महाराज परीक्षित पांडव
Translation. Maharaj Pariksit, the grandson of the Pandavas, was from his very childhood a great devotee of the Lord. Even while playing with dolls, he used to worship Lord Krishna by imitating the worship of the family deity. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. In the Bhagavad Gita 6:41, it is stated that even a person who has failed in the proper discharge of yoga practice is given a chance to take birth in the house of devout brahmanas or in the house of rich men like Kshatriya kings or rich merchants. But Maharaj Pariksit was more than that, because he had been a great devotee of the Lord since his previous birth. And as such, he took his birth in an imperial family of the Kurus, and especially that of the Pandavas. So from the very beginning of his childhood, he had the chance to know intimately the devotional service of Lord Krishna in his own family. The Pandavas, all being devotees of the Lord, certainly venerated family deities in the royal palace for worship. Children who appear in such families fortunately generally imitate such worship of the deities, even in the way of childhood play. By the grace of Lord Sri Krishna, we have the chance of being born in a Vaishnava family, and in our childhood, we imitated the worship of Lord Krishna by imitating our father. Our father encouraged us in all respects to observe all functions, such as the Radhyatra and Dobhyatra ceremonies, and he used to spend money liberally for distributing prasada to us children and our friends. Our spiritual master, who also took his birth in a Vaishnava family, got all inspiration from his great Vaishnava father, Thakur Bhaktivinoda. That is the way of all lucky Vaishnava families. The celebrated Mirabai was a staunch devotee of Lord Krishna as a great litter of Govinda.
Girigiri Gopal.
The life history of many such devotees is almost the same because there is always symmetry between the early lives of all great devotees of the Lord. According to Jiva Goswami, Maharaj Parikshit must have heard about the childhood pastimes of Lord Krishna at Vrindavan, for he used to imitate the pastimes with his young playmates. According to Sridhar Swami, Maharaj Parikshit used to imitate the worship of the family deity by elderly members. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti also confirms the viewpoint of Jiva Goswami. So, accepting either of them, Maharaj Parikshit was naturally inclined to Lord Krishna from his very childhood. He might have imitated either of the above-mentioned activities, and all of them established his great devotion from the very childhood, a symptom of a Mahabhagavata. Such Mahabhagavatas are called Nityasiddhas, or souls liberated from birth, but there are also others who may not be liberated from birth, but who develop a tendency for devotional service by association, and they are called sadhana siddhas. There is no difference between the two in the ultimate issue. And so the conclusion is that everyone can become a sadhana siddha, a devotee of the Lord, simply by association with the pure devotees. The concrete example is our great spiritual master, Sri Narada Muni. In his previous life, he was simply a boy of a maidservant, but through association with great devotees, he became a devotee of the Lord of his own standard, unique in the history of devotional service. Om Mekanatilanandasya
Yananjana Savadaya
Shri
Kripas dynamics, mercy. By some great mercy of the Lord, or the Lord's devotees. Prabhupada said, a kripa siddha means just like somebody comes and offers you $1 million. Says, here, take it. So, that's kripa siddha. It doesn't happen very often, does it? Somebody comes. So, kripa siddha is not very common. Just like honorary degree. Some people get honorary degrees. They never went to university, but they get a degree. College called them, come and take a degree. There was one man in Hong Kong, a very young man. So he was called to a university because he gave donations to the university. So the university worked on the honorary degree. So if you have a lot of money, you can get an honorary degree. Rabindranath Tagore, for he was a famous example, he got honorary degree. He wrote his books, Sharanagati, like that. He wrote his poems, and the Oxford University appreciated so much his poetry and his writing that they called him to come and take honorary degree. So it's not very common. But that's one language. Anyway, this is great Maharaj Parikshit was from the very beginning of his life. He was a devotee from his childhood. Of course, he was born in that family. He was born in the family of the Pandavas. He was the grandson of Arjuna. He was the son of Abhimanyu and Uttara. Uttara was wife of Abhimanyu. Abhimanyu, of course, died in the battle of Kurukshetra. And Maharaj Parikshit was in the womb of his mother at that time. So he never met his father. And his father was killed in Kurukshetra war. That time Uttara was carrying a child in a womb. So Maharaj Parikshit, he got, at that time there was an attempt made by Ashwatthama to kill Maharaj, to kill the child. Ashwatthama threw the Brahmastra by Uttara to destroy the child because Ashwatthama was angry at the Pandavas, he was angry at the Kurus, he was angry at everyone because they killed his father, and so he wanted to kill all the descendants. He didn't want anybody to remain to take the throne. So he threw the Brahmastra weapon at the womb of Uttara. Destroy the child. But Uttara called out to Lord Krishna to come and save her. And, well, not to save her, but to save the child. She said, I'm not worried about myself, but please don't let him destroy the child. So Lord Krishna heard the prayers of Uttara, and Lord Krishna expanded himself in the womb of Uttara and protected the child from the heat of the Brahmastra weapon. And that, from that time on, the child was known as Vishnu Ratha. One who is protected by Lord Vishnu. So that's another name of Maharaj Parikshit. So Maharaj Parikshit had actually seen the Lord. While he was in the womb, before he took his birth, he saw how the Lord had appeared there and protected him from the heat of the Brahmastra weapon. So, he had actually seen the Lord, and throughout his life, he was, well, he took birth, he became, at an early age, he had to become the king, he had to take the place of the Pandavas. The Pandavas all went off to the Himalayas. After the disappearance of Lord Krishna, when they heard that Lord Krishna left the world, then the Pandavas also left the world. They also said, there's nothing here for us to remain. And they also left the world. Before they left, they they was ready to kill that personality of Kali. But the personality of Kali surrendered to him. So Maharaj Pariksit, because he surrendered to him, Maharaj Pariksit did not kill him. But he told them, you can only stay where there is sinful activities like meat eating, intoxication, gambling, and illicit sex. But the personality of Kali then said to Maharaj Pariksit, then I have nowhere to stay. I won't be able to stay anywhere because in your kingdom, there's none of these activities. So Maharaj Pariksit was such a powerful king that in his whole kingdom there was no sinful activity. So then Maharaj Pariksit had to do some concession to the personality of Kali. So he told them, all right, then you can stay wherever there is holding of gold. Because where there is holding of gold, then sinful activities will come. That is the effect of too much material wealth, that people become inclined to sinful activities. The more there is economic prosperity, the more people are inclined to sinful activities. So Maharaj Pariksit gave that concession to the personality of Kali, and in this way the personality of Kali infiltrated into the world. Maharaj Pariksit, one day he was on a hunting expedition because the Kshatriyas, as kings, they have to be able to use violence. They have to sometimes kill. Sometimes there will be attacks from enemies and so on. And they have to be able to kill. So in order to keep themselves, to keep up their own strength and ability, they will go hunting, and they will hunt wild animals. Animals which bring terror to others. Animals like tigers and so on. They will hunt these kind of beasts. Even in recent times, it was customary in Jaipur, that the king of Jaipur, before the prince could become the king, he would have to go into the forest with a sword. And you have to kill a tiger. And the heads of the tigers are there in the palace in Jaipur. You can see the heads of the different animals which they had, the different kings which they killed. So Maharaj Pariksit, he was ruling the kingdom and he was hunting. But it happened that by the will of the Lord, one day he was overwhelmed by hunger and thirst, and he went to the ashram of a sage who had an ashram there in the forest. But at that time, the sage was engaged in meditation. And Maharaj Pariksit came there, and the sage did not receive him. So Maharaj Pariksit took a snake and put it around his neck. So this was observed by the son of the sage. The sage was called Samika Rishi, and his son was called Srini. And Srini was about 15 years old, and he was playing with other young boys at the time, and they saw what had happened. They saw how Maharaj Pariksit took a dead snake and put it around the neck of the boy's father. So Srini got very angry, and he was also proud. And because of his pride, he cursed Maharaj Pariksit that he should die 7 days from the bite of a snake bird. There are some snakes which can fly. So the snake bird touched him. He cursed that the snake bird would come and bite him after 7 days. So when Maharaj Pariksit got the news that he'd been cursed, then he did not feel bad about it. He said, it is good. He said, I have done wrong. I deserve this. So fitting. And he immediately gave up everything. He renounced his kingdom, he had renounced everything, and he went off to the holy places to look for someone to guide him and to help him prepare himself for death. And it happened that he met an assembly of great sages, and they had different opinions about what to do. But then Sukadeva Goswami appeared, and then all the other sages, they knew, oh, here's Sukadeva. He is the son of Vyasadeva. And they knew he's a very great personality. But what was most important was that he was from a devotee family. Because Srila Vyasadeva is a devotee of Lord Sri Krishna. So Sukadeva Goswami was also born in the family of devotees, the son of Vyasadeva. So Sukadeva Goswami is also a devotee. And Maharaj Parikshit is also from a family of devotees. He's from the Pandavas. Of course, Sukadeva Goswami and Maharaj Parikshit are very different kinds of people. Sukadeva Goswami is a renouncer. He's an avadut. He's completely detached from the material world. And Maharaj Parikshit, he's a kshatriya, he's a king. He's been living in opulence and so on. So it's quite different. But the one thing which they have in common is they're both devotees to Lord Krishna. And that is the important thing. That Sukadeva Goswami was a devotee to Krishna, and Maharaj Parikshit was also quite to Lord Krishna. So, by the will of providence, the two met, and Sukadeva Goswami became the teacher and guiding Maharaj Parikshit how to prepare himself for leaving the world by hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. So, that was all arranged by the Lord. Maharaj Parikshit had Srimad Bhagavatam, he became perfect, became fully enlightened. He was in trance and meditation on the Supreme Lord, and at that time the snake bird came and bit him, and his body just burst into flames. And in this way, Maharaj Parikshit left the world. So, we have to understand the significance of these great devotees, how they're devoted from the very beginning of the life. Just like Buddha. Uddhav also was the secretary of the Lord. So Uddhav also, from his very childhood, he was always playing with dolls, he was always serving Krishna like a deity, serving doll Krishna as a deity. So Uddhav from his very childhood, and then throughout his life he was like, and then you've got people like Raghunath Das Goswami. Raghunath Das was born in a family of great opulence, very, very wealthy family. So wealthy that his father was maintaining all the brahmanas in Bengal. They would all come to his father to get charity. So Raghunath Das Goswami, he was born in that kind of family, but he was not attached to it. And he gave it all up at an early age. And he went off to Jagannath Puri, the field of Lord Chaitanya. And he was very renounced. So there are many examples. Prabhupada gives also the example of his own Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. How he was a young child. When he ate mangoes, his father said, oh, the mango was not offered. You're committing an offense. So then Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, from that time on, he didn't eat mangoes. He said, no, I'm an offender. I cannot take it. And Srila Prabhupada, also, around Pramodacharya, as a young child, he was doing Radhihatra. And the children were coming, and his father would buy a lot of prasadam and distribute this is all signs of great devotees, Mahabhagavat devotees, great devotees, Nitya Siddhas, eternally perfect souls, because they're completely devoted to the Lord. So throughout their life, they're devoted to each other. So that kind of work is special. It indicates that in the previous life, they're already very advanced. To be born in a devotee family means they must have been, children must have been very advanced in their previous life, but still not yet perfect. So they've taken birth in a devotee family just to finish their time in the material world. And they shouldn't take birth again. This should be like the last birth. Because from the very beginning of their life, they're seeing the deities, they're hearing the holy name, they're tasting prasad. So throughout their life, if they keep that standard throughout their life, you know, completely pure, without any sins, so they will go back to God. So like that, we want to understand the importance of these young children and how in the past they were great souls, and they're continuing, they're coming in here, taking birth in the Krishna consciousness. This should be their last birth. And they can become also great preachers, just like Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasati. But he was trained by his father. As a child, he was trained. Father trained his children, Bhaktivinoda trained the children to help them to distribute the mercy of Lord Chaitanya. Young children, just like I was saying in Bangalore, the young boy, he learned the whole Vishnu Sahasranam, only 6 years old. So the parents are, you know, helping so much, because the parents are devotees. So, Charity kind of read, but he's learning from his parents. So that's the value of the birth in a devotee family. I think it was Srinivas Acharya. He was also born in a family of devotees. There was a household of couples. They went to see Lord Chaitanya. They went to Jagannath Puri to see Lord Chaitanya. They met Lord Chaitanya. Somehow they were able to meet Lord Chaitanya before he left the world. And then they were told to have a child. So that child became great Guru Srinivas Acharya.
One of the Panchatattvas?
Huh?
One of the Panchatattvas?
No. Srinivas Acharya was a student of Jiva Goswami. There were three students, three main students. There was Shyamananda Pandit, Narayanadas, and Srinivas. Srinivas Acharya was the one who wrote Goswami Asika. But the one who was in Panchatattva, that is Srivas. Srivas. But Srinivas is the one who was the
Jiva Goswami.
He was a student of Jiva Goswami, and he was also sent to Jiva Goswami by some other devotees. Okay, any questions?
No. How much is the children were born in a non-different and non-devotee family to become a devotee. What kind of mercy they have? The children born in a non-devotee family and the children become a devotee. Is
yeah.
That kripa?
Yeah, somehow we get the mercy of the devotee. Somehow the mercy of the devotee.
You also bring the previous devotion.
Not necessarily. Somehow, just somehow, you know. proper rest in the nectar of devotion, that usually devotional service is continuous from the previous life. But you need some devotional service in the previous life, and then you're attracted in this life. But it says sometimes also that you just simply hear, and you become interested, and you begin without any contact. You can just simply begin devotional service.
Because the eagerness of our soul? Because the eagerness of our soul become a devotee?
Yeah, we're just attracted somehow, we're attracted. People are attracted, they just want to. Of course, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, four reasons why people become devotees. Chatur, Vidya, Vidyantrima, Jnana, Sukriti, No Arjuna, Ato, Jigna, Sur, Arthardi, Jnani, Cham, Paratashava. Some people are in distress. Some people are in search of wealth, some people are curious, some people are in search of knowledge. So those four reasons, that's why people generally come to Krishna consciousness. They may have had some contact with Krishna in previous life, or may not. Of course, it's easier if they have had contact with Krishna in previous life, then it's easier to take up devotion. But even if they have it, they can still take up. Krishna sometimes chooses Krishna. There's a verse in the scriptures which says Krishna chooses.
Before you're born.
We are bringing people into Krishna consciousness.
Krishna chooses.
Sometimes Krishna may put people into different positions, different places, just to help spread Krishna consciousness.
Satsila Ekadasi. The name of the Ekadasi. Yeah. Give her. Give Cecilia. Oh.
Give me.
Oh.
Give nine.